Thank you. Elizabeth, do you want to come up with me for a second? I'm Justin Vivian Bond, and I'm very tall today. And this is my friend Elizabeth Koch. And I don't like that thing where I'm in front of somebody because I have body dysmorphia. I'm like, I always want my head to be back further so it's proportioned with other normal people. Or other abnormal people.
Welcome to the 2017 Live Ideas Festival. This whole week, we've been exploring the theme of mixed messages, looking at all non-binary forms of expression and creation and thought and ways we can view the world and ways we can make the world we want to be in. We've had a wonderful week where there's been films and workshops and conversations and performances. It's been really exciting, and there's still more to come. There's a performance tonight, The House of Whimsy, which will feature a whole bunch of really amazing performers, including Vivian and Kate, who is on this panel. An open choir practice tomorrow with Colin Self for anyone who wants to like practice vocalizing and make some cool sounds. And then a dance party, Ostara Ball, which...
To welcome the spring.
To welcome the spring. yeah.
Great. Thank you, Elizabeth. I am your moderator now. We have been working on this thing since June, I guess, this festival. And I have to move over because I can tell I'm not quite in my light. I'm a professional, if nothing else. For this panel. Thank you. I'm in Jungian. No, I'm not in Jungian analysis. But anyway, whenever I make a... I have been. My analyst does say when you come out with those words, they mean more than you actually thought they might mean. So for this panel today, I've invited an amazing group of people. We wanted to do a panel on, first of all, explain the festival to you. It's about looking at non-binary ways of approaching a lot of things, how extremism, fundamentalism, and really oppressive rhetoric and activity based on philosophies is actually causing so much strife and stress in this world. We started planning this before the election, obviously, but it does seem that we are becoming more and more polarized. And so we had one day which was dedicated to race. We had one day that was dedicated to theology. We had a trans theology panel looking at the world through various spiritual practices and how the extremism in those practices cause distress for so many people. Yesterday we had a panel here from the UN Commission on the Status of Women, which was absolutely fascinating, with some amazing activists from Sweden, from Fiji, from South Africa, and from Australia and South Africa, Sweden, Fiji, and the U.S., yeah. And New York. Yeah. Which was interesting. And this whole week, I mean, I have had to go home every night and take a Valium because it's either that or like just like try and process with my blind deaf cat, which is not always satisfying. So it's been a very emotional and informative thing. I feel like I've learned more in my 53rd year of life than I did in any of the other ones. So feel free to, you know, ex- expect your head to explode some point later in life, you young people. So today, I wanted to talk about, well, the title we came up for it was Roles, Tolls, and Trolls, the perks and pitfalls of trans visibility. And we have a group of trans activists and well-known people who have been put in a position where you have to sort of be a spokesmodel for your scenario and the pressures that go on that. We initially had Laverne Cox and Hari Neff scheduled to come, but because of their fantastic success, they are not able to be here today. Initially, Laverne was going to come, but her TV series, Doubt, unfortunately, was canceled after 2 episodes. But because she is so fierce, she has another pilot that she's shooting in Vancouver right now. So power to Laverne. And Hari Neff was also supposed to be here, but she got a film, so she's not here either. Next year, none of us will be here because we'll be working on our television and film projects. But for now, here we are, lucky as can be. So I'm Justin Vivian Bond, and I identify as non-binary. You know, I am trans. And this came in the mail today, which I was surprised to see. Beyond He or She, How a New Generation is Defining the Meaning of Gender. Mixed gender, ladies and gentlemen. So we're on some sort of cutting edge tea, but we were talking about it backstage and Kate's like, none of it's new. So I'm just gonna say that, and now I'm gonna, each panelist, we're gonna go down the line and everybody's gonna introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about their journey.
Are we starting here?
Sure.
Okay. Hi, my name's Casey Legler. It's really nice to be here. Thanks for coming out, and V, thanks for having me. Bill and Janet, thanks for hosting us. All right, so what do I do? I just finished a day of work. One of the many hats that I wear is as a GM of a really big hotel, overseeing a bunch of people, and they all decided to behave very badly today. So I'm quite tired and a little fried, but it's really nice to be here. and a lot of the issues I was dealing with actually are related to gender specifically, so I don't get to roll my eyes there, but I get to just kind of like be like, oh, fucking A, here with you guys. I also am a writer and an artist. I sold my first book to Simon & Schuster, and they that'll come out in February. I'm super excited about it. I kind of, the other thing that I'm known for is about 4 years ago, on a fluke, because I decided to say yes on that particular day to things that I normally didn't say yes to. I use my body in all of my work, and a friend who was a photographer asked if I would be willing to sit in front of her camera. And up until then, I had only sat in front of my own, kind of examining notions of objectification, the body, seeing if there was a way to undermine the male gaze, kind of maintaining agency over the body in kind of like this siloed space. So I said yes. And anyway, within the week, I was signed as a male model on the Ford modeling agency.
That almost happened to me.
And so I guess kind of like the storyline that's relevant to what's happening here for us tonight is I had the opportunity to, in a kind of unusual set of circumstances, be in the middle of essentially what I was interested in, which is the body, how we look at it, its different forms of oppression, and the way that language and images kind of perpetuate harmful mythologies. And it was pretty mainstream. So I had, you know, so I think that that's why I'm That's why V asked me. I mean, we're friends too, but I think that that specific experience is why she asked me to be on the panel with you guys today. I also have a complicated relationship with my gender identity. I definitely have a gender experience. When I sit next to my trans brothers and sisters, I definitely identify with their experience. But I have never, I don't feel like I've arrived anywhere, so it's very hard for me to identify as trans. It's also really hard for me to identify as a woman or as a man. So as of right now, those are the only options I have. So I sit in front of you on this panel about trans visibility with an identification of the experience, but not entirely understanding. I mean, I think my body's weird, but it's only recently that I've understood that kind of like my relationship to my body is similar to the trans experience. So anyway, that's my that I think that's why I'm here. I mean, you guys can tell me later.
Hi, my name is Cecilia Gentili. I am identify as a trans woman. I am from Argentina. I live in this country for about 11 years without a document, some kind of documentation status, whatever the shit is called. and I work nowadays 8 hours or more in a nonprofit. I'm the director of policy at GMHC. And I also do some acting, but I'm always like, why am I here with all these amazing people? But I guess, I don't know, they were nice to invite me. I just act sometimes when people ask me to, but it's not my, you know, it's not my full-time job. It's director of policy, you have to act a lot. Like, I pop, right? Yeah. So yeah, I'm like, yeah, do this shit, yeah? So I let's say I'm acting all the time, right? So you know, but what I do in an artistic way is I do a lot of storytellings, and I tell stories of my life, and that's what I like to do the most. I don't write them. There are stories that are always different because they I'm just revived, kind of like going back in memory line and kind of telling stories of things that happened to me. And most of the times I try to put them in a funny way. Sometimes it's hard to talk about certain, like, you know, how do you make fun about being in jail, you know, incarcerated in the with the male population as the woman that I am, you know? And it's hard for me to find ways of try to do what I do in a funny way, talking about so things that are so painful sometimes. I did a couple of plays. I had the honor to play Sylvia Rivera on O Earth, and I also play a beautiful character that was a nurse in a play called My Old Man that was written by my very good friend, Jess Barbagallo. And that's what I do. And I'm so honored to be here with all of you. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Oh, and they say that I'm a fashion icon. Go figure. Yeah. I read that. And I'm like, oh, shit.
By the way. Just like by the way.
Oh, shit. Who came up with that, right? And I'm like, I'm going to have to bring my A game. And I got this one that I don't wear it all the time. This is my best, right? So, yeah, I am involved. I like clothes, I guess. And lately, a very good friend of mine had me as her muse for her new collection. She's a designer who happens to be a trans woman. Her name is Gogo Graham. She is fucking amazing. And I was her muse for her new collection, and I did pictures at, you know, 45 years old. It felt good to be a woman, a model at age 45, and not being skinny and not being as young as I used to be. And it felt great to put this body as something that can model clothes, yes, being what it is.
Oh. Hi, my name is Kate Bornstein. I'm the old fart up here. And this past Wednesday, I turned 69 years old. I know, right? I was there, I've been there, I was there when they invented gender. Because I'm old and because I survived chemotherapy and radiation, my brain doesn't work very well, so it's like popcorn in there. Ideas are kind of popping around all the time. I'm so grateful to be in a position to provide context for the exploration you're doing into new territory I never fucking imagined would be. I knew, all right, from 1984 I came out as transsexual. I was trying to be a woman. And this was, woman meant biology. Woman meant you had a pussy. And I had a penis, and it was all about surgery and hormones. 1986, I went through surgery, genital surgery, and for the next 2 years, I tried to be a woman. It was not a, I wasn't successful as a woman any more than I was successful as a man. So I gave up on it, and I thought, okay, I'm neither. I'm not the first that was neither. I met lots of folks on my way who were neither, but it wasn't out in the world. It wasn't a thing that people were talking about. And like, you're an old fart too, huh? Oh, you older than me?
76.
Oh shit. You were there when they really invented gender. So I see my work today is providing context. I came out, there was no internet, there were no cell phones, there was library cards, you know, you went, that's where you went. There was, if you were lucky, you lived in a city that had a gay bookstore. But I wrote a play called Hidden Agenda that premiered in San Francisco in 1989. And that's where I met the illustrious, fabulous, beautiful Mix Justin Vivian Vaughn. And we co-starred with a third actor. And we toured that puppy for almost 2 years, around and around. And we... The play was about being not man, not woman. It was my first attempt at expressing that. And then my first book came out 3 or 4 years later, Gender Outlaw, on Men, Women, and the Rest of Us, which, again, it was an attempt to communicate not man, not woman. It was very serious. It was very, it was funny. Because I think it's a hoot. But I'm working on a book now, and I've written several other books, but I'm working on a book now. It's got my best title yet. It's called Trans, Just for the Fun of It. And for people who are going to give me trouble, I wrote a subtitle that they're going to have to, they won't give me trouble. It's called Compassionate Gender Strategies for Divisive Times. And that's what I'm trying to do. I think gender's become too fucking serious. And that's about all I have to say right now. Okay.
I'm Silas Howard. Can you hear me okay? Thank you. I'm so thrilled to be on the stage with you all. And I identify as queer and trans and panimal. What was that word that you said? That's my new added. Definitely tranimal identified. I'm a storyteller and a filmmaker and a really bad guitar player. I was in a punk band with Lenny Breedlove called Tribate. That was very easy listening. It was something you would just play to kind of kick back and relax. I come from San Francisco, early 90s. This is where I met Viv and Kate, and I got to work with Cecilia briefly on a project. And I also, the first time I saw Cecilia was storytelling, something that Bryn had curated. And and it was just amazing. Like I remember that night, and I remember your story and the humor, like the gravity and the humor. And that's the thing about our stories is like, when we tell our stories, that irreverent humor, how we live gets to be in the storytelling. So I'm really a fan of all of us telling our own stories, because I think like that kind of full life thing happens. But I think that's all I got to say right now. There's lots of questions I'm sure Viv has.
Well, also, but you can tell them what you do as your profession.
Oh yeah, I'm a director, filmmaker. Yes. Yeah. Is that what I do? That's what I do.
Very well.
Yes, so I was wondering, let's go back to this beyond he or she, how a new generation is redefining the meaning of gender, because I will start with you, Kate, because I know we've talked about this it's a conversation that's been going on for 20 some years, with the, maybe even longer, I don't do math, it's all that's linear. But when we were touring in Hidden Agenda, we started this show, and we would just perform it. And then we went to this place in Northern California near Humboldt, right? Wasn't that place? It was the first place we toured it to, this really small town on the California-Oregon border. And I was playing an intersex character named Herculean Barban. And I'll just tell you that initially I did not want to do the part because my identity had never been, I knew I wasn't a boy and I prayed that I would be a girl because I didn't know that there were other options for me at the time. And so when I was asked to play Herculean Barban and to be in this show about being transgender, I was just finally starting to get my swerve on, as they say, in San Francisco, where I was away from my conservative East Coast upbringing, and I was, you know, finding that I didn't actually hate all men, that there were actually queens and queers that I could actually relate to and enjoy, and I was sort of afraid if they found out that I was trans that I would never get laid again, which proved to not be true, fortunately. But we had these conversations. People really had a lot of questions after the shows. So at that time, after a lot of searching and coming to terms with it, I began to think of myself as a non-op transsexual, because I didn't want to have gender reassignment or gender confirmation surgery. I wanted to just be able to be who I was and express my gender in the way it was. And so basically, I guess I'm going to ask you now, because I'm the moderator, to talk about this, about how that time that has happened in between then and now has transformed language around these issues, and how learning, the responsibility and the frustration of trying to find the proper language to speak for yourself and for your own experience, but also coming against the frustration of so many other people who wanted you to speak for them, and what you had to say wasn't what they had to say, and how that frustration and tension plays out sometimes or has played out for you.
In those years, we began using a word transgender to be an inclusive term. What there were transsexuals, there were transvestites, there were drag queens, there were street fairies, there were cross dressers, there were closet queens. There were he-she's, there were butch dykes, there were passing women, there were sissy men. Everybody fucking with gender was somehow related. But we didn't have a word that included that as family. We were separate. We started using transgender to be an inclusive term. And I used that word in my book, Gender Outlaw. My attempt in the book was to break the binary, the gender binary, which says all you can be is a man or a woman. And in my doing so, in that first edition, I laid in another binary that said non-binary is true and good, and binary is bad and false. And so every trans woman I met hated me. They were picketing my shows, they were writing angry letters, they were calling me Kate Benedict Arnold Bornstein, set the movement back 100 years. I'm no gender outlaw, you may be. And then there were like queer folks going, you don't look like a gender outlaw, you look like a woman. I go, thank you. I've been trying to figure that one out, and I finally have. And I've written a new, like a 25th anniversary version edition of the book, where I understand that, look, it's okay. If your truth of gender is binary, fine. You just don't get to force it on anybody else. If your truth of gender is non-binary, fine. You don't get to force it on anybody else. No one's truth of gender is any better than anyone else's. And the fact that we can have many is really cool and where we've ended up. But, and I'll bring it to a close quickly. May 14th, 2014, Laverne Cox on the cover of Time magazine, Time proclaiming the transgender tipping point. It was my last day of chemotherapy and radiation, and I saw this thing. No fucking way! This is a lie. No, no, no. I know too many people. They're nowhere near a tipping point in this culture. No, 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 no. And it took me months and months and months to understand that transgender had been redefined to mean a man or a woman who transitioned out of another gender. It had replaced the word transsexual and was no longer an inclusive term. I don't call myself a transgender woman anymore. I'm a trans person. And trans now is the inclusive term. And I love that because it doesn't say the word gender, just trans. And non-binary doesn't say the word gender. It just non-binary. And that, I think, is the explosive spirit that you brought together in this festival. That it is simply non-binary. How cool is that? And that what we bring to the world through gender. But I think I'm going to continue pissing people off, disappointing other people. Thank you. And really, all I want to do is have some fun with wacky gender. So that's about it.
Cecilia, with your work as an activist and an advocate at GMHC, with language and these definitions and the people that you work with, I'm sure that you meet such a variety of people who come from all different backgrounds and ethnicities and class distinctions. How does that play out, especially when you're working with underserved populations and the priorities? You know, we're talking about language, we're talking about these ideas that were being defined in Time magazine, but in the real world experience of the amount of people that you must meet on a weekly basis, how does this resonate?
I basically don't give a shit about, you know, vocabulary anymore. It's like, whatever you come and tell me you are, I'm cool with it, right? But I stopped trying to put names into people, right? For example, I'm from Argentina, and you know, me and people like me call ourselves transvestites, right? You are un travesti, right? And we're okay with that. But now, when you know, when I use that word into, like, you know, mostly trans woman here, everybody start like fainting and like and things like. So I just, you know, I really like stop caring that much about vocabulary. And like, you know, the transsexual, like for us in Argentina, also transsexual is like for somebody that had sexual reassignment surgery. And, but that is also so like, kind of directing who you are or what you have to be through vocabulary. And like, fuck that, right? Like, why, you know, why do I have to adopt certain terminology for you to understand my body? First of all, I don't want you to understand my body, right? I don't need you to understand my body. You know, if I want you to understand my body, I'll invite you to my bed, and then we get to talk about it, right? But otherwise, I have no need for anybody to understand my body and translate it to a certain terminology, right? So I try to apply that to my work. And like, I always go to people like, oh, how, what terminology should we use with this person? And I'm like, why don't you ask them, right? And whatever they tell you, you use it. And if you need to use vocabulary, use person, this human being, you know, and don't focus it into gender anymore. I'm kind of over like, this extreme focus on genders and gender identity. And I understand that for some people it's very important to put themselves in some, you know, some kind of vocabulary or box. And I do respect it when it comes to that. In my experience, I don't care anymore when it comes to me. And when it comes to people, I just respect whatever they tell me they are, and I try to stay away from using vocabulary that involve, you know, categorizing people regarding gender identity. Does that answer the question?
Yes, thank you. And that brings me to you, Casey, because you were here, it was yesterday, with Siri and the panel from the UN, and talking about, you know, allowing people to be who they are, and that the freedom to self-identify, but then also then comes in the complication of how you advocate and how you, because for me personally, because I do not identify as male and female, I feel that the dominant culture forces me to lie every day. You know, whenever I get on a plane, or whenever I fill out a form, or whenever I show someone my ID, if I renew my passport, I have to say male. I don't want to change my name from my birth name legally, because if I do that, I don't know how many, I think I heard somewhere that you can only really like change these things like a limited amount of time. So I'm like, well, if I change my name, does that mean that if someday one of these forms actually includes a gender or not a gender, or I don't have to say I'm male or female, then will I still be able to do that? Because I don't really see what the effort, how it would be worth the effort for me to change all my paperwork from male to female, even though I feel like female's closer. But so if you can't advocate on these terminologies, how do you advocate? So I mean, that, just if you could talk a little bit about the complexities of that.
I mean, so I guess there's like two answers. One is like a very analytical answer, and then one, so through the lens of kind of theory, if you will, and then the other one is just the lens that is my very own personal experience. And so the my first answer is that, you know, we're negotiating, as I see it, you know, and again, this is just my opinion and my take on it, but we're negotiating with a system of categorizing that goes back to colonialism, imperialism, patriarchy, that relies on an organization of things in order to be able to consume it, overtake it, undermine it, like have some sort of direct relationship to it. And so so that is kind of like the context within which I work. But on a very personal level, or certainly what was being talked about last night, was this idea that in order to gather, and we were talking about it a little bit before the panel, is that there is on some level a necessity to gather data in order to change laws that are oppressive. But gathering that type of data becomes really complicated when you have people who have a similar experience, let's say, to a trans experience, but who don't have the trans identity. They won't participate in that particular data collection mechanism that would then allow for policy to change, that would then allow for them to be more protected or cared for. 'Cause I do think that social change happens not only culturally, but it does happen legally and legislatively. I think that it's something that is like multi-pronged and doesn't, there isn't one thing that's going to make it better. And I think that that approach comes very natural to me because I was raised, I was raised in the queer community, and we just, you know, out of necessity had to kind of think about, you know, where all the exits were. So I think that those are the two things that are interesting to me, is like, you know, there is this overarching kind of, and one of my trans sisters from Fiji said it last night. She said, let us not forget that there is an overarching principle of patriarchy that is really trying to organize us in order to maintain power over us. And I really do believe this. However, I also do believe that once we decide to, and to your question of visibility, right, not everyone not everyone makes the decision to participate in the construct that is around us. You know, I choose to decide to participate. I choose to participate, that's why I'm on this stage. I choose to participate publicly, that's why I'm here. My brother, who shares very similar political kind of ideology or belief system or a belief around how things are organized in the world, has made the entirely opposite choice. He lives off the grid, and that is how he participates. So, you know, one of the other panelists said, you know, we do have to end up accepting that these are the terms of engagement, and we can either engage with it or not. And so I do believe that every time I walk into a public space in a public way, I'm engaging with patriarchy directly. And so I have to be really very quick about how I move around in order to be effective. On a personal level, it actually just sucks, you know, like it's, was just said is it's really hard to kind of continue to walk around with this, you know, and I think that it's an unconscious bias towards a desire to organize things, because very decent people can become confused about my body, and so, you know, it is exhausting to constantly have to to be in the face of a desire to explain. You know, like, so what's your, you know, what's your deal? What's your thing? And that's, you know, that has its personal toll on like a very personal, interpersonal level. And then when you move into public spaces where there is, you know, kind of a heightened sense of responsibility that is exclusive to the fact that our voices are not often heard. And so one has to be, you know, as Kate said, very kind of like specific about the words that we say, because sometimes those might be the only words that get put out there. So so to your question around kind of like categorizing, I do believe that we still have a necessity to do it, but I do think that it, on a personal level, it's hard. Like, I wish people would actually just leave me alone. Like, I do act, and that's like such a silly thing to say. Like, I wish, but I know that there are a lot of people, even in this room, like, I can look around. I know there are a lot of you who are like, I wish people would just like let me walk down the street, you know, because, you know, you're trans looking. You're not even trans. Like, you just don't fit into that particular thing because you're black, because you look, you know, you're differently abled. Like, it's just like, leave me the fuck alone, man. I just want to get down the street, and the weight of those stairs is you know, kind of exhausting. But the thing is that we're within the community, we're the only ones who understand that there's a weight there. It's hard to translate that in a public way. So was that a downer? That was such a downer answer. That was like,
we're not here to tap dance into a happy joy.
That was like so serious.
No, that was wonderful. Thank you.
Because sorry, guys. I feel like it was
patriarchy, misogyny. Right.
But sometimes to have it validated the way that pressure and that just the simple weight of a stare can just exhaust you. You know, it is a very exhausting thing. So. Thank you. I do not think it's a downer. I think it's a breath of fucking freedom to hear that other people experience it.
Are you guys going to applaud after every time we say
please
something?
Please do. We love it. Like, I want to ask you, Silas, because, I will share an anecdote that happened yesterday before the panel. There was this wonderful woman from South Africa, and we were in the green room before the panel, and she was talking about American bathrooms. Now, of course, we're used to it. We're used to the fact that every time we're in public, and we're not even talking about whether you're in whatever is the appropriate bathroom for you to be in, but if you go in there, you know, this door comes up to here, there's a crack this far on the side so that whatever you're doing, your business, if somebody wants to see it, they can see it, that in this country, you don't have bathroom privacy, that that we are policed, whether we know it or not, by just the actual design of where we go to the bathroom. She said, in South Africa, if I wanted to go to the bathroom and I go behind a tree to pee, I have more privacy than I have in the United States. And so that in and of itself is an issue for every fucking body that goes to a public toilet in the United States. But Silas, you just did a big project about a documentary video project about bathrooms, and I don't want you to necessarily just talk about that, but I want you to talk about how being involved in that project puts you in a spot where you're as you are right now, forced to talk about it.
Perfect lead in. Thank you, Viv. Yeah, well, I did this project, so I've been an indie director forever, and then I got a break directing TV on Transparent, and so it was like a big shift. Thank you. It was a huge break for me, and that team is just incredible, and some of the writers I've known forever. Ali Liebegott, I know from the 90s as this, you know, writer, beautiful poetry, Our Lady J. It's just like an abundance of talent, and that gave me, you know, an ability to even, you know, get to direct more projects. So this project came via and what happened was, you know, getting that job was all of a sudden saying it matters who's behind the camera as well as in front of the camera. Mm-hmm. And so right around at that same time, Effie Brown, who's a producer I work with, was on Project Greenlight, kind of going head-to-head with Matt Damon, where Matt Damon's like, if you want diversity, you just do that in front of the camera, Effie, not behind the camera. And she went, oh, really? and so it's like, you know, that was really like a big deal to say.
I'm sorry, who's Matt Damon?
I don't know.
No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
But Effie Brown, you should know, because she's a badass. But the whole idea that telling the stories from our own perspective is important is news to Hollywood. And so getting access to that, and I was then reached out to by Mac AIDS Foundation to do a documentary series about the trans community. And so I brought on Jen Richards to do this project with me, who's an amazing actress, writer, trans woman. And we did this series. Basically, we did six people in the community. Charlie in the back is one of them, Charlie White Wolf, a young youth activist here in New York, where I wanted it to be a list of things where it's like, I identify as filmmaker, storyteller, bad guitar player, dog butler, whatever, trans. You know, trans is the lens I view the world through, but it's not the leading thing, you know? And so I really curated this group of people where it's like, these people are so incredible, and they're activists, and they're in your world, and they're making the world better for all kinds of people. And we're not existing in this bubble of transness, like the trans in the plastic bubble, you know, where we're just like on the other side of communities that were embedded in, involved in other communities. So that series is coming out on Showtime this summer, featuring six people in the community. And the part that we did in addition to that is a PSA section that was Trans 102. So it was basically like talking, direct to camera, all of various celebrities in the trans community, breaking it down about jobs, healthcare, media representation, and bathrooms. So we thought we were gonna miss our opportunity because it's not getting released until this summer, the whole series of eight, the PSA and the doc.
You thought that problem might be solved.
I thought it might be, I thought we missed our opportunity. So the, and you know, when the whole thing happened with North Carolina, I was like, oh, and then like, but it never goes out of fashion. Gender confusion in America never goes out of fashion. So we did release it just recently again. Viv and Cecilia, you're both in it for to sort of break down. And for me, also gender nonconforming voices in this is such an important aspect of our community that it's like I really love that. And Charlie, as you know, for you identifying that way, that like our, the gender question with bathrooms not going towards a binary blending privileges thing, which is what comes up so often with the bathroom issue. So that's the project.
I have a quick question okay. That came out of that last answer.
Okay.
Because I too heard two words answer. Together that I'd never heard together before. What's a dog butler?
A dog butler is a very honorable position to have. That's where you pick up your dog shit and feed your dog. That's a dog butler.
Oh, yeah. I always wondered what those people were called. I'm a cat fancier myself. But that brings up another subject, which actually occurred to me after this festival was programmed, which is, and I met somebody at an event a week or so ago about trans design, and evidently Susan Stryker is working on this project about trans design, because, and this is something that I'm just throwing out there because it's a new one to me, but and it goes back to the way that bathroom stalls are designed, for instance. You know, the way people think that if you are building a public building, you put two bathrooms in, one for men, one for women. Maybe one for, you know, people who have special needs physically or whatever. But the idea of opening the consciousness of architects and urban planners about trans design, which doesn't simply apply to the unique complexities of being a trans person, but which actually simplify the design of modern life, which is if the door goes to the floor and you shut it and you're alone in the toilet, nobody else need know who or what you are in there. And then if you have good hygiene, you wash your hands and go about your business. But that whole idea is just part of, I guess, an agenda that we need to look at. thank you. Exactly, and hopefully.
Well, and I think that the whole, what I find with media fascination, like, I feel like I've been part of a lot of year of people, like the year of the woman, I got to be in on that. And the year of the queer, I got to be part of that. And then the year of the trans, like there's all this way that capitalism loves to other keep
Can't
us.
Can't we just have the life?
Exactly. And so the, but the thing that the media visibility, media representation does is it acts as though, you know, everything's just happened today, right? As though we were just discovered today, as though we've just been going to the bathroom today, you know? And so, you know, that's clearly not true. And this idea of visibility and hypervisibility, the way that so many of us are looked at all the time and yet invisible. And so what I find with this whole media fascination and sort of the way that it, that media kind of grabs pieces of our lives and then feels good about itself is that, you know, it's saying equality, but what we need is equity, right? We don't need all the same. We need help to actually have the same advantage that people have had all the time. So I just think that that's something that, unfortunately, visibility doesn't take care of quite often. It sort of it further tokenizes.
Well, let me ask you, this is another question that has been bothering me for a long time. You know, when I went on tour with Hidden Agenda in 1990, it was the year that the NEA defunded, the government defunded the NEA, it was specifically queer artists. And I decided that I was going to make my mission in life to be a queer artist and to be visibly queer. Unapologetically queer artist, and I set certain goals for myself, and you know, I had a successful cabaret act called Kiki and Herb, which I did for many years, much longer than I would have, thank you, but I did it for much longer than I would have, because as an artist it wasn't really, and as a person it wasn't really serving me personally, it was actually not feeding my spirit to do that, but I had reached a level of success, and every time I would think, well, this is it, I'm going to go and do something else now, someone would say, well, would you like to do your show off-Broadway? We'd like to produce you off-Broadway. And I thought, well, a queer, freaky show like this off-Broadway? Well, yes, okay. So we went and did off-Broadway, and then I announced to, you know, people, this is it, I'm stopping after that run. And then they said, well, what could it take to entice you to do it again? And I was like, well, I would like to play some sort of landmark concert hall. Well, where would you like to play? Carnegie Hall, thinking that they would say, yeah, right. But anyway, then we did play Carnegie Hall. And then after Carnegie Hall, I was like, okay, that's it. And I went back to college to get my master's, so I could not do that anymore. And then they said, well, we'd like to bring you back. Would you like to play Broadway? I said, I'll do it for 3 weeks. I only wanted to play Broadway so I could say I had played Broadway. And then, you know, we played Broadway for 5 weeks. But my point then, after that, you know, I was so exhausted, and what I had to do to get to that point, and then when it's over, to think, now, is this what the level of career, is this what I want to maintain as my practice and as my life? Do I want to commit my energy to being on this level? And the answer for me was no. But also, in thinking about how exhausting it was and what it took to get there, and that then you think people are going, oh, well, I can do that too, to which I would reply, why would you want to? But also people might think that they're expected to. When people see successful people and think that that is what they dream of or that's what they want, that I wonder about setting up unrealistic expectations for people. You know, I don't live that life. I have been on the Carnegie Hall stage. I have been on Broadway, but it's not what I want to do, because it doesn't feed my life. It doesn't feed me to be in those places. So I guess I'm asking you, as well-known people who people look to as role models, how you feel about where you've gotten and how you think you're perceived and how the expectations that, it's a really complicated question actually, but, and But the responsibility is there just inherently if you're a thoughtful person. But how we communicate the realities of the capitalist success that people look at and think that's what I'm supposed to do. Because that is kind of how it's portrayed, and I don't think it's fair.
That is so dangerous, though, like to kind of like prep people into having to go to certain places, and at the same time it's so disrespectful to do that, because maybe those are not the places where people want to go, right? And it is this understanding that we all have to reach a certain level of success that most of the time is not ours, right? It is the level of success that is dictated by, I don't know who the fuck does that, but it is not ours. And I remember being a very successful whore, right? And I was fucking successful. I was a very good sex worker and I made a lot of money. And I think like we have to define whatever success is for everybody and like and kind of like reclaim it, right? Whatever your idea of success is, as whatever you want to do, you have to find a way to reach it or not without having all this pressure, if that makes sense. Right? It is, what is respectable, right? What is respectable? Oh, you have to be a respectable woman. What the fuck is respectable, right? You know, what define respectable? Like, you know, define like successful. What, you know, why is it we have to keep kind of like you are allowed to be whatever you are as long as you're respectable, right? Okay, yeah, you get a little leniency into being who you are because you are respectable of something. Sometimes we don't want to be respectable, or we don't want to be successful, or our ideas of success are different, or we can try to be successful at things that are not seen as success, right? As like being a sex worker, right, for example. And
I think that as trans people, we're so often feel a pressure to justify our existence.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that's part of it. Yeah. And that is also a real frustration, and it has been one that I've lived with coming from the conservative background that I come from, and the, you know, finding a level of acceptance within myself, but also how you are perceived as a representation of your community or your family or your circle of friends. And so
it has to do, I think in my case, personal case, it has to do with survival. I always like have my mom, you know, in my back telling me like, be good at something because you're gonna have a hard life. So at least you have to be good at something. And it follows me everywhere. Like, you know, the thing like you have to be good at whatever, you have to be good because people are gonna respect you somehow more because you're good at something. And it's that pressure that I feel her, like actually like do fucking feel her like in my neck. Like, you know, be good at something. At least like people are gonna respect you. Like nobody can respect me for what I am. They have to respect me for what I do. And sometimes I don't do things that are respectable, and that's okay with me.
I think it's, I've taken on as part of my own responsibility of being visible, Auntie Kate, over the years to go, oh yeah? Well, how about this part of me? In 1995, I was invited to ride in the Grand Marshal's car at a gay and lesbian pride parade. And that's great. And then I was also performing a solo show in the same town where I come out as being very heavily into BDSM. And the organizers of the parade said, "Oh no, 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 no! You're into SM. You can't be in our parade." Okay. About 7 years ago, I was invited to be on the board of directors of a very fancy, dancy national LGBT organization. I said, "Wow, that's an honor." You know, me? Okay. And they said, "Yep, all you have to do is make sure you either donate $10,000 a year or bring it in somehow." No. Just fucking no. I'm not going to put that kind of work. That's not how I want to work. I don't want to work for the fucking money. I want money to stay alive. I want money to be pretty. But it takes me a long time to make $10,000, and I'm not going to give it to them. My first book, Gender Outlaw, on the hardcover, I look like Martha fucking Stewart. I was the transsexual you could bring home to dinner. And when we came out with subsequent books, it's a harder look, because that's what I wanted to do. Now, I'm embroiled because I call myself a tranny. I've called myself a tranny for 30 years. Tranny was a family word of freaky people who fucked around with gender. And it was how we stopped infighting amongst ourselves. We went, "Yeah, we're all trannies together." And that was great. And now, you were talking about sex work being disrespected. I said, "Well, people are objecting. Why are you calling yourself a tranny?" I said, "Why not?" "Well, you Google tranny and look what you get." And I did, and I got like 40 million pages of tranny porn. I went, "Cool." You know?
Pretty sure that was one of them.
I'm starting to feel uncomfortable up here. I have to be honest.
And one more thing.
Oh my God.
You were talking about being defunded in the NEA and when those times of doing Hidden Agenda. Do you remember Jesse Helms was running for re-election, and we wanted to donate a week's takings of our show to the campaign of the guy who was running against him. Mm-hmm. And they said, "Oh, thank you. May we list you as anonymous?" What? "Well, if we say who it's from, of course it would hurt us." We said, "Fuck you." And we kept the money and we got prettier. So.
And where are they now? I'd like to open I'm sure some of you may have some questions or some things to say or something's been triggered within you. Please feel free to share. Dean. Oh, can Elizabeth... Do you need a mic? Elizabeth's going to come over to the microphone. She's going to be over here. Elizabeth Dean. Elizabeth.
Hi. My question is for all of you, and it's about brokering confrontation, because each of you has had success in both kind of like a fringe audience and also to a larger audience, which might be more mainstream, quote unquote, and how do you broker that level of confrontation where with like your peers or your family, you don't need to kind of justify yourself or kind of explain anything about your story, but the more mainstream your success becomes, the less education the audience might have, and also the more adversarial you might feel toward that audience. Mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering how and when, like visibility is not enough, right? Just being visible is not enough. So when is the right time, or do you see a time when there will be more confrontation as opposed to just visibility?
I'll start by answering that. You know, the interesting phenomenon for me in choosing to step into a more public space, which I just feel like saying that I have chosen to step away from it. This is the only thing that I've done in a long time because it's V. And then I did something down in South by Southwest because they bribed me with a visit to go see some queer youth down there. And it was interesting because there was actually not a lot of confrontation in the spaces that I walked into because they actually didn't know what I was. And so I actually held a lot of power. I was also 36 when I started walking into those spaces that are specifically fashion. And so being 36, coming from the activist background that I came from, I used all of my different strategies that meant actually being the one who held most of the knowledge or the words and understanding that I was being given an opportunity and that I was the one that had to maximize the impact of that opportunity. So the burden was on me to actually engage in all of the diplomatic skills that I'd learned as a young kid coming up that involved out of that developed out of a necessity to be safe, but that proved to be extraordinary in getting me into really big spaces with people who normally don't mix, particularly with masculine presenting people like me. They prefer, you know, they prefer V. I mean, let's be honest, right? So, because you know, you're just prettier. But the truth is that, so that's not where most of the confrontation came from. Most of the confrontation actually came from within my community. And that confrontation was, and I think that sometimes that happens, lateral violence is a real thing. And I feel grateful for the conversations that I was able to engage with because the main question was, Casey, we all know that you wear men's clothes and you pass. So, you know, it's not a big deal that you're ending up in these places because you actually, you pass. And so the point was taken and I understood my privilege. You know, I'm a tall, white, able-bodied, you know, classically handsome human who, if you're queer, it's not rocket science that they put me in, like, you know, fashion magazines wearing men's clothes. However, coupled with language is where it got to be really effective. So the only strategy that I employed consistently was that every time an image was taken of me, that there were also words that I was giving to that language. And the only thing that they consistently refused to print was the calling out of all of my elders that I did at the beginning of every interview. So I think that the answer, for me at least, is very complex and complicated, but also when I came home to where, you know, home to my people, I was talking with a friend who is now my wife, and one of the things that we said was like, you know, that, that at the end of the day is the only place I have to go back to. And to Silas's point of like, you know, they can think that we're fancy for all they want, but at the end of the day, if I am not careful in those really public spaces that ultimately just are interested in consuming me in some way, I will not actually have a place to go home to for me. You know, other people negotiate it totally differently and the stakes are different for them. But for me, that feels that's how kind of confrontation has occurred. It hasn't occurred out there. Like, they're happy. It's new. It's shiny. Let's fucking devour the shit out of it, you know? The confrontation and learning how to navigate it has actually happened at home.
Yeah. No, go. In terms of navigating indie world and sort of Hollywood potential fuckery world, I think that I think narrative is very powerful and very dangerous. And so, especially when our narratives are being told sort of out of our control, it can be very tricky and a tough fit. The opportunities I've had, I'm really grateful for because they're doing different things, but there's not a lot of that. And then there's scarcity. And, you know, there's otherizing and tokenizing, and it's real and it's terrible. And you watch people, everyone thinks something looks, you know, that visibility equals safety, it doesn't. If equals success, it doesn't. Equals a job, it doesn't. and it's painful, and it runs on fear, and it runs on not enough. And you know, people in power, they're like, hey, your power and my power is double power. But for all of us on the outside, it's like, oh, there's the rule of one, you know, and one only in this capacity. And you always got to talk about, you've got to explain yourself all the time. Like, you are only allowed to exist if you're explaining yourself, if you're not fitting a heteronormative. And that is changing in TV. And it's changing because, yeah, it's changing. And so that old style sanitized story and people writing that aren't from the world, like, you know, I think what I try to do is just go towards, I go back to my group of, my favorite storytelling is my community and my people. Like, that's, you know, some people are like, oh, you'll get to do something not queer and trans. And I'm like, why the fuck would I want to do that? Like, that is not my goal. Like, I just want to tell more queer and more deeply trans and working class and, you know, for me, the stories that I still want to see. So I just go between the great fortune I've had to make, you know, to work on a show that I care about or any, or shows I care about to get paid after so many decades of work and put it paying out of pocket. But I always just run back to my community to tell our stories. And so I think that, I don't know about I know that conflict is, the confrontation is in me, mm-hmm. about just bringing my family everywhere I go. And that burden of representation that I carry, that, you know, other people telling our stories don't. And sometimes they can do really better jobs in moments that they're not battling burdens that I feel. But yeah, that's what the conflict is. It's really sort of in terms of where I come from and sort of not trusting the world of mass media, which shouldn't be trusted, in my opinion, is difficult. And yeah, navigating that kind of conflict and not enough. It's a structural system. So like glossing over and grabbing pieces doesn't actually address the systems at play, keeping us all out. You know, again, going back to equity, not equality kind of thing.
And I just want to add that, you know, I think that at the end of the day, it's like those who can engage directly. I was storytelling this when I read a part of my memoir 2 days ago. I was like, you know, I come from an activist background, and in affinity groups, there was always those who were willing to get arrested, those who were not willing to get arrested, those who had the money to help people get out of jail, you know, who couldn't get, it was like everyone decided their level of engagement. And I think that it's important to stress, you know, I think in some of the things that I understood Silas just saying is it's like everyone participates to the varying degree and negotiates, you know, the limits that they can stomach. And that level is different for everyone. And, you know, in the same way that it's like, you know, people being like, you know, just, you know, gender, whatever, like whatever gender you are, I'm fine. It's like whatever level of participation you want to engage with in this public sphere is yours to choose. But I do think that I would actually say, you know, that we did say that visibility doesn't save lives. I actually do believe that visibility saves lives. So I beg to differ on that count.
I'm going to take a little, rather than debate this, I'm going to go to my go-to strategy for dealing with conflict, and that's always been comedy. Owning the comedy inherent in a trans identity, at whatever level you're being trans. Back, transsexuals were what you could laugh at. That changed when transsexuals became transgender. Now you can't laugh at transgender people, but you can laugh at genderqueer people. Ha ha ha, look at those ridiculous people. Now there's a starting to be, according to Time Magazine, a more respectable element of that, and they won't be laughing at themselves. But there's always a level, and I've tried to maintain myself in the position of a laughable identity. I'm old. I'm like, my new gender identity is little old lady. I own it. I love it. It's a laughable identity, and I'm comfortable in that. Going on the bus with Caitlyn Jenner and six trans ladies to travel around for 6 weeks on a fucking bus. Talk about lateral. Jenny Boylan and I were like, before we got on that, she, brilliant, brilliant artist, writer, politician, smart, everything. Too conservative for my tastes. and I'm too fucking outrageous for hers. But we had to get along. Caitlyn Jenner, right-wing wingnut. I'm a left-wing wingnut. We had to get along. And doing that in front of the camera actually helped. You go, no, I'm going, hi. And rather than explode, you learned how to choose the option. I learned how to choose the option of starting to find common ground. I learned that one on that fucking show. So comedy and finding common ground.
Yes. I wanted to add to, you know, basically to what you were saying, like, I encounter a lot of people that, you know, offer space and offer, you know, possibilities to do work. And I found myself, like, kind of manipulated to do the work that they want to hear from me. And, like, it is a lot of, like, morbosity, and people wanted to learn about the pain of being trans, and like, and I'm like, you're not gonna hear that from me. It's gonna be a lot of like sex in the bathroom. It's gonna be a lot of like turning tricks. It's gonna be a lot of like stealing makeup from Macy's. You know, you know, if you're looking for that like story where I'm like, oh, she suffers a lot, and but then she puts some effort and conquers the world. It's not, that's not interesting to me to say, right? And if you're gonna open a space for me to tell a story, let me tell my fucking story. I'm not gonna tell the story that you want me to. I have those, like, you know, inspirational, like beautiful, from pain to happiness stories. I can tell you thousands of those, right? But what is interesting to me is to talk about, like, you know, going on your knees to suck a dick in the bathroom. That's, you know, or staying up and having some sex or sex, right? So it is like a lot of like manipulation about the stories that people want to hear from me personally. And I have very much of an issue with it.
And as far as a confrontation with me, I mean, when I am upset or I'm thinking about something, once in a blue moon when that happens, I'll like write something and I'll post it on either, you know, one of the platforms. And I'm willing to engage in confrontation or to discuss issues with people who I respect and whose opinions I value. I don't feel like I have any interest whatsoever in defending myself to people who are ignorant or disrespectful. And one of my tenets is never read the comments. So I don't read the comments that people write on what I say unless it's, you know, on a platform that's contained. And the only people who I really am ever hurt by with confrontation, and who I've been most deeply hurt by with confrontation, are the people that I love, the people who I care about, the people that I grew up with, who for whatever reason are incapable or unwilling to see me for who I am. My confrontation within myself to continue loving them, to continue to be a part of their lives in spite of the pain that they cause me. These are the profound confrontations and difficulties. And, you know, like, I was dating a guy who one time was like, you're just a fag on E. And then, like, a little while later was like, you're really just a woman, a heteronormative woman, and I'm a fag. And what I basically did was I fucked him and then I dumped him. And, you know, that was a good strategy, I think.
This is for everyone. Do you feel like invisibility is actually creating space for intergenerational dialogues to take place? And do you feel like generations of trans people are actually listening to each other? And what are your hopes surrounding all of that?
La Mama every year puts on a festival called Squirts. Dan Fishback has been coordinating this for years, and I've been able to participate twice, and I'm stunned by that kind of intergenerational possibility. I love it. Yeah, I make myself visible for that reason. I say, use me, come on, you know, I've got a platform. How may I help you? And sure, that's what I think our job is those who've already attained some visibility, is to offer that kind of welcoming to others.
And also I feel like younger people are more, I'm just speaking from my experience as now I'm, you know, I'll be 54 in May, but the language that we were struggling with to come up with when we were on the road in those days in the early 90s, we didn't ever really, I mean, I never came to any sort of, you know, way of, we never found the answer, you know. But a younger generation of people have found the answer. And it is through dialogue and interaction with them, people that are 10, 15 years younger than me, who gave me the freedom through their language to become who I am today. So I think that is one of the most important gifts that I have experienced, is to see the fruition and the freedom of some of the struggles that we were not able to overcome or solve, but the questions that were being asked went on to become addressed by people who are more facile, whose experiences were different, who had a different level of freedom and a different kind of pain and a different kind of joy than the ones that we had. And so those things made it possible for this festival, Mixed Messages. It's about that. It's about transness in a way that's not binary, because there have been so many other shades that have happened since those days. And so thank God that we are able, either on the internet or in person, to interact with people of other generations, because otherwise we would all be really in the dark.
I would just to go off of that real quickly, sorry. Okay.
The question was, is there a possibility to create a strategy that kills gender? Well, we were talking about this yesterday with the panelists from Africa and Sweden and Fiji. And the fuck gender and gender is over movements that people are sort of use, the language that people are using today. And it seemed in that conversation that in other parts of the world we haven't evolved enough to get to that point, because it's so the ways that people are forced to survive and the gender segregation that makes it impossible to be anything other than a man or a woman makes it, there's no safe space to even begin to address that conversation.
Have you thought about boycotting certain states and certain companies that are, let's say, want to define who you are?
The question was, have you thought about boycotting certain states or companies who want to define who you are? Like North Carolina.
I was invited down to North Carolina to two colleges right after HB2 had reached its peak of villainy. And I wasn't going to turn that down. I was going to say, yeah, there were some queer kids in college there who need to know that there are some people looking out for them and trying to speak on their behalf. So, no. It is
also some boycotting going on in Texas. But I think all these boycotting techniques are really applied to, like, binary, it's trans people in a binary way. I don't think that they are exactly what you are looking for, kind of like dismantle gender. It is some boycotting around.
Spending our money on their enterprises.
Well, so I'm just going to jump in here and say, you know, again, that we're up against a kind of a larger, I believe, institutional infrastructure. And there are different strategies that are not reserved to or related to specifically gender, right? Like, there are people who understand how to do, how to not pay your taxes. And you put it in a fund, and then, you know, it gets held off in a way, and it's, you know, legal. And that's how you defund your money from the government. Now, is that a strategy I employ? No, I don't. I have an opinion about its effectiveness. But there are, and I think that one of the things that was mentioned at the very beginning is it's like, you know, this myopic focus on gender can sometimes distract us, I think, from it being a locus point where oppression exists. And one of the things that Chase from the ACLU said last night that was really interesting, he said, you know, it would be really great if we could start thinking about gender in the same way we think about racism as something that has been created that organizes, you know, Chase has an understanding of the infrastructure within which we live that's based on, you know, maintaining slaves. That's why we have the prison industrial complex. He has a lot of super interesting things to say about it. But I thought that that was so kind of like, it was one of those moments where my head kind of popped open, where I was like, oh, you know, and I know this, I'm well schooled in kind of like gender theory, but it's like this idea that that if we do get too focused on it, we forget that it is just one of the places where oppression exists, and we're particularly positioned as kind of like differently gendered humans to have language and lenses through which we can look at it, but or storytelling around it. And for those of us who want to storytell it to people who don't already have the language, we can, but not everyone wants to, you know, like if you're just like, fuck the police, like that's totally, that is, you know, we need you as well, I think, you know, like there are different ways of engaging.
I think it's scary. Where to me I get scared and back away is when we start employing the same tactics and points of view that are used against us, saying there is a vast right wing that hates us. No. There's a segment of that right wing that has fucking power, and some of them hate us, but they're not monolithic by a long shot. No, they're not monolithic. Those are the ones in power. But there are right-wing wing nuts like Caitlyn Jenner who are working really, really hard to fund grassroots organizations. Well, I think it's...
You don't like yourself.
I'm really curious about it. Important, but I can't hear it.
Yeah.
So
I guess the question was, is that in states like North Carolina, do we have enough trans men to go down there and go into the woman's bathroom and see what they say about that? Take your birth certificate with you. Go down there with your beards and everything else, the trans men, and go into the women's bathroom.
So that's actually a tactic that they've been employing in Texas, and it's absolutely not effective at all. It hasn't changed the legislation. What? It's still happening.
So they allow that then in Texas?
What I'm saying is that it's a strategy to demonstrate to demonstrate the kind of laughability of forcing people who clearly are not of the specified gender of the bathroom to go in there. And so trans men, I mean, I love that they're they have testified before the Congress, you know, friends have sat there, and it was a very specific strategy that the ACLU actually employed so that they would testify and say, this means I will go into the bathroom, and it did nothing. So
it just puts
trans men in danger. So, you know, I understand your grief and I understand your frustration. And there are a bunch of creative ways to engage that are way more malleable, I believe now, to undermining existing systems that don't necessarily involve kind of like the predictable things as boycotting or, you know, direct confrontation. I think that, you know, we're all really creative. Like I said, like, you know, we all know where the exits are. Silas?
Well, I was just going to say.
We have one more question.
We only have time.
Just one last, one quick thing to that, which is this is where visibility and, you know, all our visibility doesn't necessarily save us, but it is on the road towards making us undeniable, unstoppable. So it is important. And it's, I think that that visibility is.
Thank you, Silas. We have time for one more question. Someone back here.
Wait, there's a question in the back.
Hey, guys. How you doing? I guess my last question would be, what has empowered you, like, from the time you were, like, a child to now? And what keeps you empowered? Then how would you empower the youth that are today and keep them inspired?
I'll start off. I go to my elders. I stay close with my elders, and I love them. And my job is to take care of them and break bread with them and listen to them. And then when I get invited to go down to Texas the way that I was, I got to sit with 3 hours and problem solve or bear witness to problem solving about points of resilience around these kids who are in high school, who are ostensibly no longer allowed to use the bathroom that they feel safest in, how they're going to go to prom, right? How they're going to go to prom safely. And I realized that none of them understand the history that they come from that's about flagging. Like, I was raised by, like, everyone had, like, a different fucking, like, handkerchief in their back pocket, the side that it was on mattered, like, where, you know, like, there were codes. And so we got to talk about that, and they were really excited. So they're manifesting it through makeup, which is really great. You know, I don't know what the fuck they're going to do with that information, but I think that that is, and in that, you know, afterwards, they were like, oh my God, you know, Casey, thank you so much for coming. And I absolutely know that they have no idea how much resilience they offered me. Like, there just is, you know, I believe that I got more out of that than they did. So my job is to tell them, and I'll just tell a very little story, and then I want to hear what these guys have to say. But my wife went to the UN, and they gave me, when I showed up to this thing, they gave me the Take My Hand Texas pin. And this pin, if you wear it, it says, it alerts other people that you will escort them into the gender, the gendered bathroom that they feel most comfortable with. And it's this beautiful kind of like hand with the trans flag on it, and it's really great. And anyway, she showed up to the UN, and so all of the pictures that are taken of her have this like little pin on her, you know, in the United States while this thing is passing. So, so you know, you never know how those things are going to work out, but I listen and go to my elders. Like, that's where, you know, that's who brought me up, and that's where I have to go back to. Yeah.
I grew up in a world where I fucking had to hide. And my strength and my power came so gradually, but it was the ability to say no. No, that's not what I am. No, that's not how I want to live my life. No, I'm not going to grow up to be that. No, I'm not one of you. No. And it made me feel really alone and really scared. It was unsafe. And where I did find strength and community was from outcasts. Drag queens, street fairies took me under their wing and said, yeah, you are, you're one of us. Mm-hmm. Oh. And those are people I could say, yeah, okay, I get it now. But it was a whole lot of no that gave me power.
I mean, it's going to sound kind of simple, but like really my community and like keep adding community to my life keeps me all the empowerment that I need and more. I wish I could give you like a more refined and smart idea, but it's my as simple as my community gives me that empowerment that I need. And yeah, it may not sound smart, but it is what it is.
Very smart.
I would say chosen family, yeah. Young people like you, Charlie, and Auntie Kate. I mean, it's really all, and my chosen family drives me crazy, and I drive them crazy, but it's like really where I live and learn and grow, and I'm inspired. You know, I make work that maybe touches somebody younger than me, and then they inspire me, and it is a conversation, and it sounds hokey. It's just the best thing I've found and will continue to reach towards and try to give my time to as well, just because that works for me. And bad humor. Making fun of myself, that's also saving grace. I haven't done it today.
My grandfather was born in 1889. And he was old when I was young. He died at the age of 88 in 1976. But when I was really young, before the age of 5, I would get dressed up in my grandmother's clothes. And my grandfather would always tell me how pretty I was. And made me feel so beautiful and so loved. And my father would say, "You can't do that, you're a boy." And I'd be like, I am doing it. And so I believed my grandfather. And I thought that, you know, it took me many, many years to find the language for who I am. But it was that one. It was that one person who accepted me and saw me that allowed me to see myself when I was young that got me through everything. Mm-hmm. So I think that if there's anything we can do for each other, it's that. Yeah. Oh. And it's a rare thing. Mm-hmm. But we, in this room, most of us, I think, have the ability to do that for other people. And hopefully we'll have the opportunity to do it. So, on that note, thank you all so much for coming.